Hello, Fringe Power Diary. Tim Trinnell here, back in time for the 2019 Fundy Fringe Festival. And I'm really late getting into production on our seventh season this year. I'm just so drained from the summer already, and I have no idea what to do for the show. F4 Fringe Power has been... Oh, I can't stand using the words has and been together. F4 Fringe Power is radio in support of St. John, New Brunswick's Fundy Fringe Festival, and I have always stylized the series. I used to think I was pretty clever interviewing local and visiting performers in a different bed each episode. An in bed with Tim Trinnell kind of thing, but everyone is doing that on the internet these days. Dear Fringe Power Diary, what do I do? What can I present local 107.3 FM? I've been listening to some old Stone Pillow segments in hopes of some inspiration.
Do you remember your first theater experience?
My first theater experience? Yes, I do. I played a mad doctor in Flowers for Algernon. Back in high school with Bob Doherty, actually.
Bob Doherty?
Yes.
A mad dog?
Mad doctor.
Oh, mad doctor.
Doing experiments on Charlie's brain.
Oh, yeah. So that was your first theater? Like, you'd never, like, been in the audience before?
Sure.
I mean, that's good, too.
Oh, my God. No, since I was five, my mother was in a lot of community theater. Mm-hmm. And I played a little small black child because the kid got sick and they hauled me on and threw some blackface on me and threw me on stage. No, that's true. What? You can't get away with that now. What was it? Oh, my God. I can't even remember the name of it now, but it was supposed to be Buddy's was pretending to be married and had three kids to get away from this woman that was chasing him. So he had hired these people to play his children, and except one of them happened to be a little black child who came running out. Anyway, he got sick the night of the play, so they threw me in blackface and threw me out. This is probably, God, 1963?
How many nights did you perform in blackface?
Just the one. My father knew nothing about this till he saw me come out on deck, and he just went, no.
No.
No, no, no. So that was pretty bad.
And how was the mad doctor bit with Bob?
That was fun.
Yeah.
That was fun. I was having some problems remembering my lines. So since I was a doctor, I had to have a clipboard, you know, like for reading the chart. So I just made sure my lines were in my chart until he found out about it. And I didn't get a very good grade in drama that term.
Did you ever perform drama again after that?
Oh, my God, yes. The original St. John Theatre Company did a production called Anything Goes by Cole Porter. Mm-hmm. And there was a lady from the Seabells, the Ladies Barbershop Quartet,
yeah.
Bessie Selby, who's no longer with us, rest her soul. She was playing a ship's passenger, and I was playing a crew person on the ship. And her line to me was, "Excuse me, seaman." And neither one of us could keep a straight face. And the director would not let us change the line. "Oh, seaman." "Start again. Oh, can we change it to sailor?" "Really? Nope."
I don't know if it was my first theater. No. My first theater, I was going to talk about me being Dancing Tree number 2, which was a hella fun time, but was not my first experience. My first experience was I was little old grandma to one of my friend's little old grandpas, and the story of, like, the giant turnip, I think was the name of the play, and literally the plot line was there's a giant turnip, and I can't pull it out, grandpa can't pull it out, the cow can't pull it out, the horse can't pull it, like, and it just went on and on until there was, like, a mouse pulling, and we all pulled on each other, and my friend didn't remember her lines, but I knew all my lines. She was good. I think she was pulled in last minute. It was like grade 2 maybe. So best first theater experience because I got the old lady makeup, even though I was like what 8. It was weird.
What was the Dancing Tree about?
Dancing Tree was my mother knew I was a star from when I tried to pull out that giant turnip. She was like, that kid's gonna win an Oscar.
She's gonna go somewhere.
So I got signed up for like a summer theater kids camp, and still in Ontario, I think. And I was originally Melting Snowman number 4, but then I got added to another skit because I was pulling off the Melting Snowman pretty well. We sang "I Will Survive" as we melted. I don't know. But I was supposed to be a dancing tree, and it was a dancing tree competition. So they're making fun of how, you know, actors are just trees in the background. Mm-hmm. So what happened is all these guys are just pretending to be trees. They're not real trees. And then we would burst out and be actual trees. And so I won the award as dancing tree number 2 for best dancer. It was like a gold spray-painted Barbie doll, I think, on like a statuette.
You still have it?
No, I don't think I actually got to keep it. I think they took it from me.
That's dirty.
They were mean.
Well, it's true. Some actors can be really wooden in their performance.
Puns.
Well, how about the first time you were actually seated in an auditorium or in like a theater space? Like the first time you were actually exposed to a performance?
Oh, man. This is like weird. It was so deep for me at the time. I know it's silly now. We went on a school field trip to see this play. No idea what it was. There was a clown and there was a snake, and it was a puppet snake, and that's really all you need to know. And the key part of this play was that the clown had a heart and the snake had a heart, and they were like paper hearts. And what happens is, I don't know what the plot line happens, but I'm sitting there and the lights are dim and no one can see me, and like the snake's heart gets ripped out. And as a little kid, I don't know how old I was, like grade 1, grade 2, I was just like crying, and you know, but no one can see me, which was the best part, so I was like really feeling it. Like I was so connected to this snake, and the clown like rips off his heart and puts it on the snake, and the clown like dies. And then the snake revives and is like, no, my best friend, and they keep passing the heart back and forth, and I'm like sobbing in the front row, and my teacher does not notice, but I was such an emotional moment for me. Like I remember it as like the saddest thing. And then eventually they split the heart and they share it amongst each other, and it was like the best moment. And I was like, I want to make people feel like this, because the sadness I felt was so real. I knew the story was fake, and I had read tons of books before that. Like, I was a big reader, and I knew all those were fake, but this was, like, real, happening in front of me. And then I was suddenly happy, and it was the happiest day of my life, and I left the field trip, and I was like, this is the best. So, like, to feel that in such a in an auditorium, it was beautiful. I loved that.
So that was a good defining moment for your pursuit in theater yourself.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That was like, I would list that as one of my three main reasons, for sure.
And everything went downhill in life from there.
Everything was awful after that. No theater has reached that experience of the clown and the snake. I mean, it was a guy holding a puppet. I didn't know that at the time.
You set the bar really high.
Well, my imagination was there. Yeah, exactly.
My first experience in theater was in grade 4. I was Sleepy E. That's all I remember.
Sleepy E?
Sleepy E.
Like the letter E?
The letter E. I was lying there very peacefully.
Why was the E sleepy? Do you remember?
Well, we all had a letter, and I was Sleepy E, and I remember I got to wear pajamas to school that year. It was the first time I think I ever wore my pajamas to class. It was great.
Maybe it was the silent E, because it was sleepy.
Maybe. It's possible.
So you didn't pursue any more theater after that?
No, that was the last time. Anything that I was involved with was backstage after that.
Yeah? You found yourself more comfortable
like
backstage?
Like set painting, and yeah, for sure.
They don't let you wear pajamas, though.
No, they don't.
Backstage?
No. Well.
No. So how about as an audience member?
I think that the first theater experience that sticks out for me, I would have been in junior high school and went to St. John High School to watch a play on stage there, and it was Theater New Brunswick, and they were doing The Miracle Worker.
Okay.
Yeah, I believe it was The Miracle Worker.
How old do you think you were then?
I have no idea.
No?
I'm just too old now to remember. But it was amazing. I remember it very vividly. I even remember the set, what it looked like.
Yeah?
Yeah. And the stairs, and it was I think it was the first time that I actually got it, you know, so it was pretty neat. Yeah. And the rest, as they say, is history.
It didn't compare to your easy E. Easy. Did it compare to your sleepy, silent E at
no,
all?
Not at
no,
all.
Performances
no.
Challenged that no. Pinnacle of your career, your sort of career?
No, that was it.
Describe your first theater experience.
Well, my first theater experience was actually very unique. I grew up in a neighborhood with
at Kate Elman Wilcott. Mm-hmm. And when I was
from Interaction Children's
Theater Company. And when I was 6 years old, her mother pulled myself and a bunch of other neighborhood kids into her living room. I think basically because she was tired of listening to us complain that there was nothing to do, and started rehearsing us with a Bernard Shaw play.
Oh.
Within the year, we actually performed that play. So my first theater experience was not actually going to theater, it was actually participating in theater.
So 6 years old, you're already doing Shaw.
Yeah.
Wow.
Not bad, eh?
I would expect that out of the Wilcott plan.
No, yeah. Well, it would. And I believe, actually, I believe she did a variation of some Shaw pieces as well. And one of the plays we ended up doing was called A Case for Two Detectives. It was fantastic. It was great. We did it at a local church with full sets and costumes. And, I mean, I couldn't even really read at the time. I read at a grade one level. So Kate would actually sit with me and read my monologues to me, and I would memorize them from her talking at me. That's how we did that.
You were about six?
Yeah.
So do you remember your role that you had?
Oh my goodness. You know what? I don't. Isn't that awful? You know what? Kate could tell you. She talks about it all the time.
But you remember the experience.
I do. I remember the experience. And I never turned back. I mean, that was the beginning of the Children's Drama Workshop, which was the very first children's theater company in St. John. And Anne kept that going for years and years. I mean, I was in it until I was 16 or 17 and in high school, and it went for years after I left and sort of went into university.
I guess, and maybe this is a hard word to use, what prevented you from pursuing performance like that, if you were so involved?
You know what? It's really funny. I sort of, I started dabbling in backstage. So when I was in high school, I actually sort of went to the directing side of things. But then it was, I grew up in a time, I went to St. Vincent's, which was an all-girls school. And during the 90s, there was a real push for women in science. And because I had good grades in science and math, I was sort of honed in that direction. And so that's what I ended up doing when I went to university. I started studying civil engineering.
So the science was romanced you away from the...
It did. You know? Yeah. And I was away from performing for a really long time.
But here you are again working in a theater.
I am here working in a theater. Yeah. It's, life is comes full circle.
What about the first time you were in an audience watching...
Other than school performances and things like that I would have experienced, which were... obviously school's concerts are a little bit different. Mm-hmm. But my grandmother was a subscriber of TNB. So from, I think I was about 8 years old when she started taking me to see at least two or three plays a year, which would have been at St. John High at the time.
What was the one that you remember the most?
The one that I have the first memory of is when TNB did A Christmas Carol, and it scared the living daylights right out of me. It really, really was. I don't even think at that point I had probably even seen one of the movies. So I went in expecting a Christmas play and got a full-fledged horror story.
Expecting something that you would typically see maybe in a school setting, something.
Absolutely, gentle, yeah. And she had front row center seats, so there was no escape.
Coming
out. Oh, it was creepy. Yeah, they did a great job.
My first theater experience that I remember would definitely be coming... But it's not really theater. Oh,
what is it then? Well, what is it?
It's like...
Is it like on a stage?
I came to the theater, mm-hmm. to Imperial Theater, to see Tap Dogs. Ooh. That was the most incredible show of my life. I was 8 years old.
That, and yeah, the dance show.
Yeah, it was a dance show. It wasn't like a theater performance.
No, that's valid.
Okay.
That's valid. So you were eight.
I was eight.
Were you dancing already by then?
I had just started dancing, and I really taken an interest in tap. And my mom saw that the Imperial Theatre had Tap Dogs coming from Australia, and so she brought me to see it, and it was incredible. They had, like, a splash zone, and they were dancing in water and all over the scaffolding. It was incredible.
That is something that probably really influenced your energy to continue the studies that you do, because you went on for theatre for years after that.
Absolutely. Forevermore, tap was like my number one, and because I kept dancing, I got a job at Imperial Theater, and then that influenced my decisions in university, taking marketing and human resources, and then I got a job at Imperial Theater.
Oh. Well, what about your first theater play? Do you remember that?
I don't remember my first one, but I did come to see Pride and Prejudice
last year from St. John Theatre Company, and that was really good.
Yeah. How about you? Have you performed in any theatre?
Never any real theatre, you know, through school. And, like, you know, I was the third butterfly from the left for a while, but I don't know if you'd consider that real theater.
Well, no, I mean, the theater experience is a theater experience, but, I mean, something as simple as that can, being third butterfly from the left, can influence someone for their path for years and years and years.
Absolutely.
My first major theater experience came in grade 5, and I was into it pretty early because I liked Jim Carrey as a kid. And one of my guidance counselors heard me always talking about how I wanted to be a comedian or an actor, and she let me MC a whole presentation for the whole school. And looking back, that was a ridiculous thing. I was definitely not prepared or ready for that, but I remember I went up and I had to lip-sync the song, and I had to, like, introduce all these different acts, and I felt like I was doing a really good job at the time, but the more I think about it, it's a fond memory because it was my first time and it was special, but it was by no means good.
I think John Gielgud even said that he would hate to see his first Hamlet. But so you continued on, though. That didn't dissuade you, even though you, in hindsight, you considered it a bad experience.
Well, yeah, no, because it was. I thought it was good then. So, moving on, like getting into grade 6, going into drama for the first time. I remember when I went for like my grade 6 middle school tour, it was so big to me that, you know, middle school was the big leagues. They had like drama club. So I got into that, and I did some plays there in grade 6. Like we did Midsummer's Night's Dream, and I played Lysander. Mm-hmm. And but then very quickly after that, it just so happened for the first time in a really long time, St. John Theatre Company was having a play where they needed kids. And my mom heard the call on the radio, and so I went out to KV High, like halfway through grade 6, and I ended up getting cast as Dill, Charles Baker Harris, in To Kill a Mockingbird.
Yeah, To Kill a Mockingbird. I remember that one.
Yeah.
I remember the short pants.
Yeah, I'm quite sure I met a certain someone in that show many years ago.
I didn't try to kill you, I tried to kill the other kid.
That's right, I was okay.
In the play.
Yeah.
In the play. No, that is, I think, the first time I remember meeting you.
Yeah,
and definitely performing with you. So, what was your first like sitting in the audience? Like, I mean, did you, like you say, you wanted to pursue this type of art because you liked Jim Carrey? But was there something that you actually saw in person in a theater, like traditional theater, sitting down, lights go up?
Actually, it's the weirdest thing to say, but no, I was never in a theater really before that. I mean, maybe school plays, like seeing performances like by, I was in French immersion, so seeing like French groups go to KV. But nothing major, actually. The reason I ended up becoming so interested in theater for me was one time in grade 3, a friend told me that I was really funny and laughed at my joke for a long time. So then I thought I wanted to be a comedian. And then going down that path, I realized, well, there's no storytelling in comedy, and I like to play pretend. So I ended up moving into theater in grade 4 when I got a little older and wiser.
Yeah, of course. It's such a different world when you're 4.
Grade four. It's completely different.
Well, because that makes a lot of sense to me, because I share the same experience. I lived in some remote communities in Williams Lake, Fernie, you know, in British Columbia, just running around, being transferred because of my... Well, we're both RCMP kids,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So it was always in those smaller communities. The only theater experience that we had available to us were those traveling companies that went around the province or provinces and did the elementary schools.
Yeah, exactly. Likely some of the first shows I would have seen would have been Fredericton's company. They performed the Playhouse. Theater TNB.
Yeah.
TNB. Theater New Brunswick.
Yeah.
Yeah, they do like 2-man, 3-man traveling shows, and those would have been some of the first things I would have seen.
Can you tell me your first theater experience that you remember?
School play, grade 1, maybe.
Were you a participant?
Or? I was. I played the moon, as I recall.
Was it a good moon? Was it a full moon?
It was, no, it wasn't. It was a crescent, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you pursue any theater after the crescent moon?
I did. I was in a couple more school plays. I think I was in a Christmas Story play. I think I might have played an angel at one point, yeah, in grade four, something like that.
Was this something you enjoyed, or did you have to do it because of school?
No, I liked it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What about the first time you were actually in an audience watching a play? How did that make you feel?
First time is kind of... I'm not sure. The first one I can really recall would be in high school. We saw a production of a Shakespearean play, and it was neat. I mean, it's neat seeing live theater. In this particular one, it was people were walking through the aisles. It was really cool, and I also remember that the guy from the commercial, the oatmeal crisp commercial, was in it. The guy that it's not oatmeal, that guy.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
That was exciting.
Yeah, it was.
How old were you then?
15, 16.
That's, really? You were excited about the oatmeal crisp guy at 16?
Yeah.
Only in theater.
I'm from PEI. We don't have many celebrities there.
Fringe Power Diary. You know why I'm so frustrated and down, Fringe Power Diary? Many folks can volunteer and billet visiting performers. All they have to do is contact The Fringe at FundyFringeFestival.com. Maybe even follow them on social media. Fundy Fringe Festival on Facebook. At Fundy Fringe Fest on Instagram and Twitter. God, do people even use Twitter anymore? What I mean, Fringe Power Diary, is that this radio program is how I support the Fundy Fringe every year. Of course, we all go to shows, where all the ticket revenue goes straight to the artist. We buy a Fringe button or shirt, or even a Fringe punch card. 8 shows for only $60. But, dear Fringe Power Diary, I'm frustrated, down, almost near panic, because I'm so late coming back to the radio series. I need to find a way to make the property even better. I'm really not that interesting a person on my own. Maybe another Stone Pillow review will help me think.
Do you know your Shakespeare characters from your pasta?
Okay.
Okay, ready?
Okay,
ready?
All right.
Okay. Cappellini.
I'm going to say pasta.
Nice. Well done. Pappardelle.
It doesn't sound like pasta, so I'm going to say Shakespeare.
It is pasta.
Okay. Oh, no.
Filario.
Oh, that sounds like Shakespeare.
That is Shakespeare. Virgilia.
That sounds like pasta.
That is Shakespeare.
Dang.
Barbantio.
I have no idea.
How about this? Barbantio.
I feel really stupid right now. Can I pass?
Okay. Fusilli Napoletani.
I know fusilli is pasta, but I don't know about the second part.
There's no Shakespearean pasta.
No.
So is it, pasta, is it?
I'm saying pasta.
Okay, good for you, good for you. Lucentio.
Lucentio? I'm going to say Shakespeare.
Yes. Guy who's in love with Bianca and Taming of the Shrew.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Sicinius Velutus.
That sounds like Shakespeare.
Yes, it is, from Coriolanus. Chatillon.
I'm going to say Shakespeare.
Nice, yes, the ambassador in King John. Macroncini.
That's a tough one. Hit me.
Oh, no, there's no hitting in this questionnaire. Sorry. If that's what you're looking for, I apologize.
Maybe next time.
I'll have that ready for the next questionnaire.
Okay, what's the word again?
Macaroncini. I mean, without a doubt, it's Italian name.
Yeah. I'm going to say pasta.
Nice, pasta. Okay. Shakespeare characters or Italian pasta?
Oh.
I don't even know if it's...
I'm not really good at Shakespeare, so...
I don't even know if this is really Italian pasta either, so...
Okay,
my
let's go.
Some of these characters will be Italian, though.
All right.
Are you good with pasta?
I'm all right, I guess.
Cool. Okay, Barbantino.
Barbantino. Barbantino. I'm going to have to say Shakespeare character.
Correct.
Ding, ding, ding.
Dolabella.
Dolabella? Pasta. What? Is that wrong?
Yeah, Dolabella. That's the... he's a follower of Caesar that approaches Antony and Cleopatra at the end of Antony and Cleopatra.
I didn't see that one.
Okay. Bavette.
Bavette?
Bavette.
With an E on the end?
B-A-V-E-T-T-E.
Spaghetti.
I don't know if it's spaghetti, but it is a pasta. I'll give you that one.
It's a spaghetti. Okay. Pasta spaghetti.
Farfalle.
That is a Shakespearean character.
No, it's not. It's
God
pasta.
Damn it! I don't eat or watch or read Shakespeare enough. Okay. Eat enough pasta.
Salarino.
Salarino.
Or, I guess, Salarino.
Salarino. Salarino. Well, Salarino. I wouldn't want to eat anything named Salarino, so I'm going to say Shakespeare character.
You're correct. Phew. Virgilia.
That sounds like a pasta. God damn.
Wife of Coriolanus.
Who? Which play was that in?
Coriolanus.
That's the name of the play?
That's the name of the place.
I never see it.
Tagliolini.
Pasta.
Yes. Girandole.
Shakespeare. God damn it.
Trinculo.
Shakespeare character.
Yes, congratulations. I have no idea. I didn't keep track of your score.
No.
Okay,
I think
here.
I got half of those wrong. Let's do them again and see what I get.
Shakespeare character or pasta?
Yes.
Okay.
I can.
Okay. Bavette.
Bavette? Shakespeare character.
No, that's pasta. Lucentio.
Shakespeare character.
Yeah, that's Shakespeare.
Farfalle. Pasta.
Yes. Okay. Sicinius Volutus.
Shakespeare character.
Yep, from Coriolanus. Fusilli Napoletani.
That's pasta.
Yeah. Virgilia.
That's a Shakespeare character.
Yeah. Girandole.
That's pasta.
Okay, very nice. Filario.
Shakespeare character.
Yep. Vermicellini.
That's pasta.
Yeah. Capellini.
Also pasta.
Yep. Chatillon.
Shakespeare character.
Gosh. Barbantio.
Shakespeare character.
Good. Macaroncini.
Pasta?
Yeah, pasta! And Ragusine.
Gonna say pasta.
No, that's a Shakespeare character. But you did really well. Congratulations. Prisoner in Measure for Measure. Do you know your Shakespeare characters and how to differentiate them from pasta?
Let's see.
Okay. Chatillon.
Shakespeare.
Good. Dolabella.
Pasta.
No, that's Shakespeare. Ragusine.
Shakespeare?
Yeah, Shakespeare. Okay, yeah, it was Prisoner in Measure for Measure. Okay. Salarino.
Shakespeare.
Yes. Farfalle.
That's pasta.
Okay, All right, good. Virgilia.
Shakespeare?
Yes! It's the wife of Coriolanus.
Okay.
Trinculo.
I'm going Shakespeare again.
Very good.
I don't know what Shakespeare characters these are.
But
I know pasta.
Okay. Pappardelle.
That is pasta.
Oh, wow. Very good.
They're wide and they're very good.
Are they?
Yeah. It's long and wide. Yeah.
That's right. Mm. Of course. I would have seen that when I researched the names. Lucetta.
That's Shakespeare.
Good. Girandole.
Shakespeare?
No, that's a pasta.
Really?
Yep.
Oh. No, that's a... Yeah, that's a...
Okay. Asinius Veludus.
Shakespeare.
Okay. Filario.
Shakespeare.
Yes. Fusilli Napolitani.
Pasta.
Good. You're killing this.
Fusilli is round.
Good. Okay, good.
Like corkscrew.
All right. Okay.
Yeah.
Barbantino.
I'm guessing Shakespeare because I don't know the pasta.
Good, because I pronounced it's Barbantillo from Othello. I don't know.
Oh, from Othello.
I put Tino for some reason there.
Okay.
Capellini.
That is pasta.
Very good. Okay, well, thank you, Shelley. I still think you passed.
I like pasta.
You do like
That's it.
So, dear Fringe Power Diary, why am I so late with the radio program this year, you ask? Well, Fringe Power Diary, I recently visited my parents out west. Haven't seen them in 8 years. Some relatives I haven't seen in over 25 years. Albeit it was for a funeral. No need for your condolences, Fringe Power Diary. I didn't really like the guy. But Mom wanted as many of us there as possible. I did it for Mom. Saw daughter Wilhelmina. Wedge is now sweet 16, and this is her last year being eligible for equestrian summer camp, so she's not going to be helping us with the radio show again this year. For the first time in almost 15 years, I have a full-time day job in St. John. Benefits and everything. Plus, I've been busy with projects for my award-winning one-person theater narcissist 12 company. The cats are good, but they're a handful. Sally Deadpool 3 is so naughty, yet so loving. And Angus has experienced some much-needed weight loss. His sore on his elbow is still, you know, kind of a problem. You know, kind of like my own tricky arm. Yes, Angus is definitely a great addition to Team Tim. I did, however, find time to see the new Spider-Man movie. Mm-hmm. Not my favorite webhead flick, but I really, really have been enjoying how Disney can buy up a great established creation and make the property even better. Disney. Property even better. Dear Fringe Power Diary, I'll be right back.
This is Sarah Rankin, your friendly, fundy Fringe Festival director, and you're listening to Local 107.3.
St. John's Alternative Radio, Local 107.3 FM.
Dear Fringe Power Diary, I've got it. I have got an idea, a plan, a brilliant device. I am going to sell this F4 Fringe Power Radio series to Disney. Think about all the amazing things they'll do with the program, just like all their other franchises. In fact, I'm going to sell the Fundy Fringe to Disney too. The whole Fringe Festival, all the way to Scotland. I mean, the broker fees I'll get alone will set me up for life and everyone will love it. I just can't wait to be king.
This one is Samuel Beckett quotes.
Oh.
The Irish playwright. Or Kanye West tweets.
Okay.
Nothing's funnier than unhappiness.
Beckett?
Yeah, okay. Habit is a great deadener.
West?
No, that's...
Yeah, I'm gonna suck at this.
Sometimes I get emotional over fonts.
Beckett.
No, that's Kanye. You're on Earth, there's no cure for that.
What?
You're on Earth. There's no cure for that.
West.
No, that's Simon.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
If you have an apple, and I have an apple, and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still each have one apple.
Beckett?
No, that's Kanye.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
These are hilarious. Yeah.
Fur pillows are hard to actually sleep on.
West.
Yeah. Words are all we have.
Beckett.
Yeah. What do I know of man's destiny? I could tell you more about radishes.
Beckett.
Good, very good. All right, going to round three. Ooh. Can you differentiate between a Samuel Beckett quote, the famous Irish theater author, playwright, or a Kanye West tweet?
I think I can try.
All right, okay, so dance first, think later. It's the natural order.
Kanye?
No, that's Samuel Beckett. Nothing is funnier than unhappiness.
Not Kanye, Sam something?
Sam Beckett, yeah, that's
Sam Beckett. All right. I remember the name now.
He wrote Waiting for Godot, probably one of the most revered plays in human history, really. According to a CBC poll, the most influential plays of history.
I've heard of it, but I've never seen or read it.
I have not seen it, but I have read it a few times. And let me say, it's easier if you think of Muppets as the characters rather than actual human beings. But Shakespeare came in second. I think it was Macbeth or Hamlet that came in second in the poll. But the first one, the first most influential play of all time in human history, is supposedly, according to this CBC poll, Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot. Okay, next one. Habit is a great deadener.
Kanye?
No, that's Samuel Beckett again there. Sometimes I get emotional over fonts.
There probably wasn't any such... Or, well, there was fonts. When was Samuel Beckett from?
He was, you know, last... you know, he died a couple decades ago, so...
Okay.
It would be the last century now.
You would know about fonts. They've all been Sam Beckett so far, so probably Kanye, but that might be the thing that they're all Sam Beckett, so I'm going to go with that.
I would have gone with Kanye. That was a Kanye one. No, it was good, though. What do I have to do to get a simple Persian rug with cherub imagery?
That's gotta be Kanye.
Yeah, that's Kanye. Totally Kanye. You're on Earth. There's no cure for that.
Beckett?
Beckett, yeah. Good, good, good. I just threw some kazoo on this.
It's a tough one, but I'm gonna say Kanye.
Yeah, well done, well done. Congratulations, you did well. Thank you. Quotes from Irish playwright Samuel Beckett or Kanye West tweets. Okay. What do I have to do to get a simple Persian rug with cherub imagery?
Kanye West.
Okay, good. Ever tried, ever failed, no matter. Try again, fail better.
Sam Beckett.
Good. What do I know of man's destiny? I could tell you more about radishes.
Sam Beckett.
Yes, that is Sam Beckett. Good, good for you. Okay. If you have an apple, and I have an apple, and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still each have one apple.
Samuel Beckett?
No, that's Kanye
West. That is Kanye West. It's an interesting tweet.
Yeah, it is. I don't even think that one's real, because it's really long. Fur pillows are hard to actually sleep on.
Kanye West.
Kanye West, good. Okay. Sometimes I get emotional over fonts.
Kanye West.
That is Kanye West. I was trying to trick you there with the words. Dance first, think later. It's a natural order.
Samuel Beckett.
Good, yeah.
I'm doing pretty well.
Yeah, that's good. Habit is a great deadener.
Samuel Beckett.
That's Samuel Beckett. Good. I'm ready to get out of my own way. The ego is overdone.
Kanye West.
Good for you.
I told you I was going to do good. That's awesome.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's what happens when I am when I'm on Twitter all the time and I follow Kanye.
I don't have Twitter.
Yeah. Well, I haven't I didn't recognize a lot of it. It just seemed like something Kanye West would say.
There was a poll taken in about 2001 of what the most influential play was out of the Greeks, out of the Shakespeare canon, out of all the musicals.
Okay,
that's it. The top play that they say is the most influential is Waiting for Godot by Sam Beckett. So Samuel Beckett, of course, if you...
Yeah, no, no.
Yeah, Irish playwright. Now, can you differentiate between a Samuel Beckett quote and a Kanye West tweet?
No way, no.
You want to try?
Yeah, sure.
All right, great. Okay, there we go. I'm ready to get out of my own way. The ego is overdone.
That's Kanye West.
Good for you, good for you. That is Kanye West, okay. Sometimes I get emotional over fonts.
That's Samuel Beckett.
No, that's Kanye West too. Okay. Habit is a great deadener.
Beckett?
Yep, that's Beckett. What do I know of man's destiny? I could tell you more about radishes.
I'm hoping that's Beckett.
That is Beckett.
Yeah.
Good, good, good. You're on Earth. There's no cure for that.
Beckett?
Beckett again, yeah, good. I ordered the salmon medium instead of medium well. I didn't want to ruin the magic.
Kanye West.
Kanye West, good, good. If you have an apple and I have an apple, and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still each have one apple.
Kanye West.
Good.
I'm impressed by Kanye
West. Yeah, I know. Well, I selected the best ones of Kanye. It's he does.
Whenever he's 12.
He's not a ringer every time. Yeah. We are all born mad. Some remain so.
That's Charles Bukowski, isn't it? Samuel Beckett?
It does sound like Charles Bukowski. I think he had something similar, but that is Beckett. You're right. Words are all we have.
Kanye West.
No, that was Sam Beckett. I got you on that one. Okay. I just threw some kazoo on this.
Beckett.
You're teasing me now. Oh, yeah, one more. Here, I'll give you one more. Nothing is funnier than unhappiness.
Beckett.
Well done. Awesome. Very good.
Are you serious? That was the number... Waiting for Godot is number one play.
Waiting for Godot is the number one play.
No way.
All recorded mankind. All recorded history of mankind.
I can't believe it. No, like, more than Hamlet, more than...
Hamlet. Actually, I don't think Hamlet even made the top five. I think if I remember correctly, the second place play was Macbeth.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. I think Hamlet did bigger.
I think Death of the Salesman was another. I think it was third.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Thank you.
These stone pillow segments were really fun. As you know, dear Fringe Power Diary, the name Stone Pillow is an homage to Lucille Ball's 1985 TV movie. The title complemented my worn-out In Bed with Tim Janelle theme as I randomly asked people on the streets theater questions. I really must do this again. I'm sure Disney will agree and demand it after I sell them this program.
So is this a wrestling finishing move or a Pulitzer Prize-winning theater play?
Okay.
Trouble in Paradise.
Play.
No, it's a wrestling
move.
It's a wrestling move.
Are you kidding me?
Okay. Ruined.
Ruined.
Yeah.
That's a play.
That is a play. That is a play. Ruined is a play by Lynn Nataj. 2009, actually. She won that. Okay. Running Man.
Play?
Did you yes, say? It is a play. It's for it's by Cornelius Eadie.
Is he?
Oh, and Deidre Murray.
Was Arnold Schwarzenegger in that one?
No. No. This one came out in 1999, though. when Schwarzenegger's, what, the 80s? Yeah.
Okay.
Razor's Edge.
Wrestling Move.
Yes, the Wrestling Move. Attitude Adjustment.
Oh. That would make a great finishing move name.
Wouldn't it?
It would. But judging by your facial expression, I'm going to say play.
Wrong! It is a wrestling
move. You tricked me.
Okay. I did trick you a little bit there. Okay. Rapture Blister Burn.
Oh, wrestling move.
No, that is a play by Gina Gianfrido.
I'm going to guess now I'm not going to be winning any prizes.
No. Okay. Walls of Jericho.
Play.
No! That's... I thought I was giving you that one. That's Chris Jericho. Chris Jericho's finishing move. Walls of Jericho?
I haven't watched wrestling since the 90s.
Sister Abigail.
Well, that has to be a play.
No, that is a wrestling move as well.
That's... How can you hurt somebody with that name like that?
Okay. I'll give you another one. Widow's Peak.
Wrestling move.
Yes! Congratulations! Can you tell the difference between a wrestling finishing move?
Ooh.
Or a Pulitzer Prize-winning play.
Really? Okay. This will be interesting.
The Flick.
And these are plays?
Plays. Pulitzer Prize-winning plays.
Play. I'll say a play.
Good. Yeah, by Ann Baker, 2014. Mm. Pedigree.
Play.
No, that's a finishing move.
Really?
Yeah, I think it was... who does the Pedigree?
I don't know.
Stone Cold Steve Austin?
It's kind of new. Okay.
Ruined.
Play.
Yeah, play. Code Breaker.
Play.
No, that's a finishing move. Two Trains Running.
Play.
Yeah, by Austin Wilson. 1992, he got that. Mm-hmm. Attitude Adjustment.
Wrestling move.
Yeah, it's a wrestling move. That's a good one there.
Who was that, Mr. Perfect?
You know?
You don't know?
I don't know.
Okay.
In the Blood.
Play.
Yeah. Susan Laurie Parks. Sister Abigail.
Play.
No, that's a finishing move.
Really?
Yeah. Rapture Blister Burn.
Play.
Yeah, that's a play.
Okay. That sounds interesting.
It is. Kill Switch.
Play.
No, it's
wrestling move.
Yeah. Twist of Fate.
Play.
Wrestling move.
Oh, man.
Hellbent for Heaven.
I'm just going to guess wrestling move.
No, that's a play. Play by Hatcher Hughes.
Nope.
It won in 1924. Watch wrestling at one time in your life or not, right?
Probably yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is this a wrestling move or a Pulitzer Prize winning play? Pulitzer for theater arts.
Okay.
Trouble in Paradise.
Play.
Sounds like a play, but it's a wrestling move.
Oh, is it really?
Hell Bent for Heaven.
Wrestling move.
No, that's a Pulitzer Prize winning play. Hatcher Hughes. Actually wrote that in 1924. Pedigree.
I'm going to say wrestling move.
Awesome. That's a good one there, yeah. Widow's Peak.
Play.
That's a wrestling move.
That's
Two Trains Running.
Trains Running or wrestling move.
That's Pulitzer Prize winning play of 1992 by August Wilson. Walls of Jericho.
Walls of Jericho. I'm going to have to say wrestling move.
Good. That is a wrestling move. Yeah. Camel Clutch.
Wrestling move.
Good. That is a wrestling move. Ruined.
Wrestling move.
By Lynn Nottage, a 2009 winner. Diamond Cutter.
Play.
Wrestling move there. That was good, though. The Piano Lesson.
Wrestling move.
It's the way I say it, isn't it? I'm that good. No, that's...
Oh, it's a play?
That was August Wilson, 1990 winner. That's when they turned into a movie, Piano Lesson. Oh. Sister Abigail.
Wrestling move.
Oh, crap. Good for you. No one gets that one. Like, what kind of wrestling move is Sister Abigail? Right? Okay. Okay, I'll give you All the Way Home.
Wrestling move.
No, that's a play. That's a play. Okay. 1961, won by Ted Mosell. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Literature background you have, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So you'd be prone, more than others, to identify what is a Pulitzer Prize-winning play versus a famous wrestling finishing move.
Yes.
Yes? Okay, good. All right, good. That's...
Although I don't... I'm not really up on my Pulitzer Prize-winning plays, but...
Okay, all right. Well, yeah. I'll try to stick to the more famous and recent ones.
Yeah, okay. Okay. That's fair.
Okay, so is this a famous wrestling finishing move or an equally famous Pulitzer Prize-winning play?
Okay. Okay.
The Canadian Destroyer.
Oh, that's going to be wrestling.
Oh, yeah, you're wrestling. Okay. Ruined.
Oh, God. I'm going to go with wrestling again.
No, that's a Pulitzer Prize-winning play. 2009 by Lynn Nottage. Okay. All right, no worries. No, that's good. This is fun. Razor's Edge.
I'm going to go with play.
No, that's a wrestling move.
Okay.
Okay, not a problem. No, this is good. This is good.
Okay.
Twist of Fate.
Are these trick questions? Like,
no, okay. No, they're just...
I'm going to go wrestling move on that.
Good, good. Yay! You got that one. Wrestling move. Yay, all
2 out of 4. Okay.
Buried Child.
Buried Child. That's got to be a play.
Yeah, that's a play. Sam Shepard. Okay. In the Blood.
It's probably another... I'm going to go with play.
Yeah, okay. Susan Laurie Parks. Okay. 2000. Hey. All right. Rapture, Blister, Burn.
Oh, it's got to be wrestling.
It's Gina. Gina Gianfrido. Gina Gianfrido, 2013.
Okay. Okay, I suck. Anyway.
No, this is fine. Trouble in Paradise.
Another trick. Okay. I'm going to go with wrestling move.
Good. It is a wrestling move. Sister Abigail.
That's got to be a play.
No, it is a wrestling move.
Oh, it's a wrestling. Okay.
All right, I'll give you two more here. Okay. You're doing good. I think you're par for par here.
Maybe.
Okay. All right. Hellbent for Heaven.
Well, I'm going to say wrestling just because of the bent, but I know it's a play.
It is a play. Yeah. Patrick Hughes, 1924.
Yeah.
Disgraced.
That could go either way.
Especially the way I say it, too.
Disgraced. I'm kind of, you know. Okay, wrestling.
No, that is a Pulitzer. I had Akhtar, 2013. And, okay, so here, one more. Let's do it.
Okay.
Widow's Peak.
I'm going to say play, but I know it's wrestling.
Final answer?
Wrestling.
Yay! Wrestling! Thank you very much.
Well, dear Fringe Power Diary, I'm off to research Disney contact information and develop my sales pitch. A little bippity-boppity-boo, and I'll close the deal. Then the world will enjoy all things Fringe Disneyfied. I wonder if I can copyright Disneyfied. I'll return soon, dear Fringe Power Diary, with some interviews of performers coming to the 2019 Fringe Festival this August 19th to 24th. Wakanda forever.